This is a repeat of a firing line program originally telecast on January 27th, 1974.
Dean Rusk is, I suppose, by everyone's reckoning, the principal historical victim of the Vietnam War. Perhaps for the sake of meticulousness, one should specify that he is the principal surviving victim of the Vietnam War. Those who write our history would appear at this moment to be all but unanimous in believing that our venture in Vietnam was a disastrous mistake, and that Dean Rusk, who was appointed Secretary of State by John Kennedy, and left the Department of State only after Richard Nixon was elected, was the principal symbol and indeed practitioner of a foreign policy of which our participation in Vietnam was the spinal column. Indeed, after Mr. Rusk left Washington, there was an embarrassing interlude during which it appeared that he was unemployable, that he was being treated like an ex-commandant of a concentration camp looking forlornly for a job. That, of course, ended when he became Sibley Professor of International Law at the Law School of the University of Georgia in 1970. His career has been extraordinary. Born in Georgia, he worked his way through college, graduating from Davidson and winning a Rhodes Scholarship. He went subsequently to California to teach at Mills College, meanwhile learning law at the University of California. He enlisted for war service and performed many duties, winning many awards, exposing himself to great physical danger in various fronts of that war, leaving the service as a colonel. He went then to the State Department and in due course was given the office of United Nations Affairs, and then after that, Far Eastern Affairs. From this, he resigned in order to serve as president of the Rockefeller Foundation during a period of 8 years, dispensing $250 million to those he thought less fortunate than he. He was invited by John Kennedy, who had never before met him, to be Secretary of State. We're living in a period when the revisionist historians are getting a great deal of attention, not alone in the tabloid press, but in the academic journals. I propose to ask Mr. Rusk to examine this compulsion as regards, for instance, the Vietnam War. But before that, a simpler question. Is it your opinion that the same revisionist syndrome is responsible, for example, for the school of thought that says Oswald didn't murder Kennedy, that the whole thing was a plot of some kind?
Well, first, Mr. Buckley, let me charge you with having picked up a remark of your friend, John Kenneth Galbraith, who wrote in the New York Magazine some months ago that I was in exile down here in Georgia, that being in Georgia was like being in Ulaanbaatar, the capital of Outer Mongolia.
I didn't say that.
Now, this notion that being in Georgia is in exile is limited to a few circles on the northeastern seaboard.
Excluding me.
It's great to be here. It's great to be here. No, I think that when you have a tragedy such as the Kennedy assassination, that questions about it will persist for at least a century. I must say that I have not myself seen any information, but I haven't made a career of it, that leads me to doubt the basic conclusions of the Warren Commission report. I do recall that Senator Richard Russell of Georgia, who was on the Warren Commission, did say before he died that there was some doubt in his mind about whether Oswald was acting alone. Now, just as in the case of other major events in the past, the assassination of Lincoln and things of that sort, there will be questions. What the final and full truth will be, I don't know. I will conclude my remark on this point by simply saying that I personally am completely convinced that no foreign government was behind Oswald, because we made the most intensive investigation of that at the time and found no basis for any such supposition.
I was asking you that question less to inquire about who killed Kennedy than to wonder whether that appetite to doubt the official version is a part of the more of the generic appetite to doubt, for instance, the motives of the United States and its foreign policy during the 50s and the 60s as we lead up to Vietnam, We know that it has been very popular in the last 5 or 10 years to assume that the origins of the Cold War are our doing rather than their doing. And you are sort of held up as the perfect establishmentarian symbol of someone who rather unthinkingly, village idiot, is there to certify a series of events because those were received by you.
Well, there is an element here that might be worth a notice. You know, Thomas Carlyle said in Sartor Resartus that there were a few nuggets surrounded by a lot of nonsense. But he wrote to his publisher, Mr. Fraser, that at least what I've written will be eye-catching. Now, I think there is a kind of fadism that creeps in to political writing, historical writing.
Their sins are scarlet, but their books are red?
Columnists. Mm-hmm. I mean, if columnists simply wrote what was being put out by the wire services, nobody would read them. They've got to find something else, the offbeat angle, the odd approach. So, you know, there is a little distortion that comes out of the desire to be read, to attract attention, to make a bestseller. And we have to keep that in mind, I think.
Well, this certainly would account for some of the sensationalists, but I really wasn't talking about them. I was talking about a breed of historians, of whom William Appleton Williams is more or less conceded to be the godfather, over a period of 10 or 15 years have been writing books saying, look, what happened was that Stalin found himself beleaguered by Western interests, which were in one part political, but mostly economic. And under the circumstances, he had to maneuver as best he could, and you take it from there. Now, I take it from your sublime indifference to the work of these people that you don't fret about it at all. You simply assume that they will go out with the dirty laundry when history finally moves in on them. Is that correct?
Well, the legitimate historians are always in the process of revising history, mm-hmm. whether it's based upon new archaeological finds or some documents of the 19th century that crop up. But I don't believe that we should roll over and play dead just because someone writes a political tract and calls it history. Now, in the case of Mr. Stalin, at the end of World War II, the United States disarmed its fantastic forces almost completely and almost overnight. By 1946, we did not have a division in our army or an air group in our air force rated ready for combat. We went into the United Nations with a plan, the Baruch proposals, to turn all nuclear materials over to the United Nations to be used solely for peaceful purposes, a plan under which no nation would have nuclear weapons, including the United States. Secretary Marshall invited the Soviet Union to be a part of the Marshall Plan. Now, it's true that we might have had some trouble getting appropriations from Congress had the Soviet Union accepted, but it was the Soviet Union that walked out of the Paris meeting of the Europeans who were planning their end of the Marshall Plan. No, Joseph Stalin looked out across the West, having remarked in a wartime conference, the Pope, how many divisions does he have? And he saw no divisions. He tried to keep the northwestern province of Iran. He demanded the two eastern provinces of Turkey. He ignored the peace treaties of Eastern Europe with respect to free elections. He arranged the coup d'etat in Czechoslovakia. He blockaded Berlin. He gave the green light to the North Koreans to go after the South Koreans. Now, that's the origin of the Cold War. So I don't think that all the writing in the world can change the essence of the situation.
Well, I wasn't so much intending to elicit from you a historical narrative with which I'm familiar and with which I agree, as inviting you to speculate on the mood that is hospitable to a rather grotesque distortion of what it is that happened. I suppose there are people who say that Hitler is terribly misunderstood, and that what he really wanted was a perfect racial harmony. Now, what would be interesting is less that there should be historical perverts than that X number of people listen to them, and X number of people with rather solid intellectual and moral credentials. And it's on this primarily that I'd like to hear from you, rather than on the fact that I happen to believe that you are correct historically.
I'm not sure that I can answer your question about motivation.
Is it a psychological or a social problem?
It may vary with each individual.
It have roots in anti-Americanism?
Perhaps in part, but perhaps some of it is motivated by the feeling, in the case of the best of them, that if we, as Gandhi put it, think the best of the other fellow, he will try to live up to our expectations. I mean, some of it may be at a fairly high level of hope and aspiration for the future. Some of it may be based upon an original ideological commitment in terms of starting with the answer and then writing a book around the answer. Some of it may be simply the matter of wanting to attract attention. I don't discount the possibility that some of these gentlemen writing in the so-called revisionist historical field may be genuinely convinced that they are right, because after all, historians do disagree among themselves. I think we ought to distinguish between historical writing that is based upon the evidence, and the evidence of these years about the beginnings of the Cold War is now becoming public as the archives of the State Department, for example, the Foreign Relations of the United States series comes out. And many scholars can now go through that material and make up their own minds and bring about any correctives that they feel will be required.
Well, but bringing about correctives suggests a desire to learn the truth. Let me give you what I think is an interesting anomaly. The entire academic world was outraged that the Plumbers Unit commissioned Howard Hunt to go over and falsify some of those cables you were sending to Saigon. The intent of this maneuver, as I understand it, was to link President Kennedy directly to the assassination of Jim. Well, in fact, it didn't work, or it was given up, or it was apprehended, or whatever. Meanwhile, during this entire period, members in good standing of the historical profession were taking bits and pieces of statements made by Cordell Hull and Franklin Roosevelt and Joseph Stalin and splicing them together without any reference to chronological integrity in order to prove an a priori point. But there has been no outrage that I have, I'm aware of, against them, though they certainly did more violence to their profession than Hunt did to his, it being his profession by background to simply attend to whatever espionage or counter-espionage services he was commissioned. How do you account for that?
Well, I think in academia, all points of view have a chance to be heard. I have the impression...
Even yours?
Yes. Yes, although there were moments when I was a public official when I did not feel that way on some campuses. It's in the essence of a university that all points of view be examined. But I have the impression that there is some reaction now against the so-called revisionist historians that we will hear see more of in the years ahead as the evidence, the documents, the materials become available for examination by honest writers.
Is there an appropriate academic discipline against people who do that a kind of thing in your judgment, or merely the obloquy of their peers?
Oh, I'm passionate about free speech and free press.
And, well, including freedom consciously to dissimulate?
Well, I think even academicians have the right of free speech and free press. I do think that the obligations of academic freedom within the classroom impose certain standards of truth and objectivity.
Well, is this...
But when a man goes out and writes a book, he can write a book about anything he wants to and say anything he wants to.
No, I'm not disputing that. But that's why I started off by saying, is there an academic discipline? A man who exercises a right of free speech does not have a concomitant hold on a college to keep him employed if, in fact, he shows that he's violating the basic integrity.
Well, my guess is his peers will make judgments about his integrity.
But they're not doing it. I'm telling you they're not doing it.
That depends on the part of the country, the particular campus, the particular group of peers. I rather respect, in the long run, the ability of the scholarly community to ferret out the honest men from the frauds.
Well, it's significant that you started off the conversation this afternoon by talking about 100 years. For 100 years, people will some people will believe in the grassy knoll
right.
or whatever. And in 100 years, they'll find out that Gar Alperovitz knows nothing about the origins of the Cold War. Well, does that mean that you expect that your own vindication, if it's going to come, will almost necessarily be posthumous?
Well, as far as I'm concerned, yes. Because the documents in the Kennedy and Johnson libraries on foreign policy will not be available until about 1990. And well, I can assure you I won't be around then.
Well, can't we ask Ellsberg for preliminary copies? let's take something very concrete. As you know, David Halberstam wrote a best seller in which you were one of several victims, many victims. And he recounted an episode which might be illuminating in terms of instructing us on the kind of problem that you face as Secretary of State, and that you face even now, if we assume, as I do, that you're on the side of a correct history. He said that on one occasion you got so angry, which is atypical in your case, that you practically shook Tom Wicker at the table, and you said to him, "Why does the New York Times always get things incorrect? The New York Times said this morning that some Buddhists have got hold of the radio station at Hue, and this is a dreadful and typical inaccuracy." According to the story, months later, Wicker was in Hue, and he actually checked there with American officials who said, yes, indeed, the Buddhists had got hold of that station. Halberstam concludes this episode by saying Wicker was right, and Wicker, thinking of Rusk and his obvious sincerity, decided then that the real problem was that Rusk et al. Had created an elaborate machine to lie to them, only to become prisoners of their own lies.
Well, in the first place, David Halberstam made no effort to talk to a good many of us about some of the things that he put in his book, including words that he put in our mouths. He made no effort to be in touch with me by postcard, telephone, letter, interview, or anything else. The same was true with Walt Rostow. The same was true with Lyndon Johnson. I can name some others. So that he did a rather sloppy job of reporting. Now, had he talked to me about that particular situation, I could have told him that it just wasn't so. He didn't have to believe me. He could put in parentheses. Dean Rusk says this is not so, but I don't believe him, parentheses. But
nothing about it is so?
No, that's right.
You mean the Wicca thing,
the first place,
Buddhist,
the
radio station, all made up?
I did not lose my temper with anybody when I was, that is, in the way in which they could detect it, when I was Secretary of State. And I did not jump Tom Wicker on this kind of a point. It just isn't so.
So you have no memory at all of an episode involving yes or no, did the Buddhists occupy a radio station in Hue?
No, but I think he had me doing this at an embassy dinner, didn't he?
Yeah.
Well, the last thing in the world I would do at an embassy dinner would be to lose my temper and shout at somebody.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's just impossible. It never happened.
No, but the social collision apart, was there a point at which you were taking one line and the New York Times was taking another line about whether the Buddhists in Hue had occupied the radio station?
There might have been. I mean, there were so many things happening there during that period that I don't rely on my memory anymore, and I have no documents or papers or anything. So I really can't say categorically yes or no to that particular question. But the way in which he presented it was wholly false.
He goes on to say, again, what is very widely accepted, that the foreign policy as conducted by you was largely directed, largely flowed from a trauma of the 50s, which they call the Joe McCarthy era, without necessarily saying that Joe McCarthy was himself responsible for the public mood, but that he's sort of the easiest eponym for deciphering that. Now, as these people view things, what happened in the 50s was that the shock over the loss of China, rather savage handling of the State Department by congressional committees, made you all so nervous and so apprehensive that when the 1960s came around and a Democratic administration was installed, you proceeded with such trepidation as to make these major mistakes, fearing that you would be thought of as a part of that continuing political leadership, that as a result of stupid errors and pusillanimity ended up in losing the Far East to the communists. Is that correct?
Well, President Kennedy took office as the first president born in the 20th century, and he was prepared to take a fresh look at almost every question. But recall that he was presented very early with a major crisis on Berlin by Mr. Khrushchev at the June 1961 summit meeting in Vienna. Now, what were we supposed to do? Take our troops out of Berlin? Turn access over to the East Germans? Or did we have an obligation to the people of West Berlin? Mr. Khrushchev put missiles in Cuba, which would have provided a battery of missiles which, without any advance warning, could have destroyed much of the strategic air command and would have created a political situation in this hemisphere and in NATO which could have been disastrous. Then there was the steady movement of personnel and arms from North Vietnam into South Vietnam. Now, President Kennedy didn't ask for these things. What he wanted was the Peace Corps, the Alliance for Progress, the Food for Peace program, the Test Ban Treaty, which we finally achieved, and things of that sort. But here we had these things on our plate. Now, you didn't have to go back to the McCarthy period to say that the United States has and has had since the end of World War II a direct responsibility for the safety and the freedom of the people of West Berlin, and that we would not accept in this hemisphere a battery of missiles that would have the effect of those missiles in Cuba. We weren't working under the aura of McCarthyism. On the matter of Peking, I would have to say that I had a long talk with President Kennedy about China policy, and he had in front of him a resolution of Congress just 3 or 4 years before he took office, which was, I think, virtually unanimous, if not unanimous, strongly opposing the admission of Peking to the United Nations. All right, what was he to do? He was rather cautious about selecting the issues on which he would do battle with the Congress. And he decided that on this issue, there was not enough in it to open up the eye-gouging debate and controversy that would have resulted had he made a change in China policy. Now, I think perhaps it may be fair to say, whether it's McCarthyism or not, that maybe only a Republican president could have gone to Peking. Because I can just hear Everett Dirksen and others sounding off had a Democratic president gone to Peking.
And Richard Nixon.
And Richard Nixon.
Well, I find very instructive. But I think that you skirt a little bit the Vietnam issue on right. Berlin and on Cuba. As we both know, the criticism is at least slightly less intensive. But on Vietnam, it is contended that our traditional position was anti-colonialist and isolationist to the extent that you could be isolationist. Mm-hmm. That the big switch came when Dean Acheson, who had something quite other in mind, what he wanted to do was persuade France to permit West Germany to increase its steel production. In 1950, promised France that if it would agree to permit West Germany to do so, America would send military equipment to Indochina. This according to the school of thought, was the beginning of an involvement in Vietnam which was very much opposed to the American tradition. Do you agree?
Well, at the time of the Truman administration, we did two things about Southeast Asia. One was to assist the French, it's true, with both economic and military assistance for Southeast Asia.
Are you glad you did that?
But at the same time, put very strong pressure on them to move as quickly as possible toward independent states in Southeast Asia, to come to a political settlement in Southeast Asia. And the French governments of that day were not strong enough at home to come to that conclusion. Then, of course, the Korean War raised the question as to how far the communists in Asia were going to go. And so we put the 7th Fleet between Formosa and the mainland, and we stepped up our assistance to Southeast Asia. But during the Eisenhower administration, we concluded the Seato Treaty, along with a treaty with Korea and the Republic of China. So when President Kennedy had to look at this problem, he had to consider the effect upon other security treaties of our conduct under the Seato Treaty. In other words, if the United States, in his judgment and mine, should prove to fail to show credibility and fidelity to a security treaty, what judgments would be made in capitals like Moscow about the NATO treaty or the Rio Pact in this Western Hemisphere? We've been very much concerned over the years about the possibilities of a misjudgment and miscalculation. Now, whether we're moving into a new period, we don't know yet. I think we're a little prematurely euphoric about detente. But nevertheless, I think we ought to pursue possibilities of agreement, but keep our wits about us. But we were very much concerned about the structure of collective security with respect to it wasn't just Vietnam or even Southeast Asia. It was the structure of collective security. Now, that idea has been rapidly eroding, particularly in the United States.
But what idea?
Of collective security.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm.
But we're not addressing ourselves to the question of what we put in its place in terms of organizing peace in the world. And in a nuclear world, that's a pretty important question.
Well, the England was a signatory to the Seato Treaty. And according to one account, you once, let's avoid losing your temper, you once upbraided an English diplomat for not having sent even token military representation out to Indochina, thus discharging its commitments. Would you say that the relative aloofness of England from the Seato venture caused it to suffer that implausibility that we'd have suffered if we failed to move, or are they just simply too junior to matter very much?
No, I think that if the notion of collective security is eroding in this country, as I think it is,
yeah,
it's for a reasons for which I can understand. If the American people come to the conclusion that collective security will require 40 or 50,000 dead every decade, and that it isn't even collective, we put up 90% of the non-Korean forces in Korea, 80% of the non-Vietnamese forces in Vietnam. Then they're likely to say that this doesn't appear to be a very good idea. I personally believe that the greatest losers in this mood of withdrawal from world affairs among the American people are the nations of Western Europe. I saw a study not long ago where some professors went around the country asking questions on this subject. At one point, they listed about 12 of our allies and friends, ranging from Great Britain, Germany, France, Japan, and they put Israel on the list. And they asked the question, if such and such a country were attacked, would you be in favor of using the armed forces of the United States to come to their assistance? No ally scored 50%. Israel's score was 11. Now, I personally think that it would have been in Britain's interest to have the British flag flying in Vietnam, not just because of what it might have contributed in Vietnam, but because of what it might have done to the attitudes of people in this country about joint ventures and problems of this sort.
Well, knowing what you now do about the human condition, and knowing what you obviously must know about the disparity between what it is that people should do and what it is that they in fact do. How do you defend the conduct of the South Vietnamese war? Do you now feel that it was a grave mistake, a tactical mistake for which you and Lyndon Johnson and McNamara are responsible, to assume that you could win a war fought out over a period of 4, 5, 6, 7 years, given the manifest and accelerating impatience of the American people?
Well, I think I personally made two mistakes in judgment about Vietnam, at least two, shall we say. One was that I underestimated the tenacity of the North Vietnamese.
Why?
Well, they took casualties which, compared to population, would be roughly equivalent to 10 million American casualties, and kept coming. And I'm not sure why, because in the Korean War, there came a point where the other side was ready to negotiate, and I just personally did not believe that they would persist to that extent. Now, this is a very controversial remark, but my guess is that they were encouraged by evidences of political division in this country and were encouraged to hang on, believing that they could achieve by political means what they could not achieve by military means.
And they were quite right.
And they were quite right. The second mistake I think I made was to overestimate the patience of the American people.
Overestimate?
I overestimated the patience of the American people. Yeah. The American people are very impatient with respect to wars, casualties, because basically we are very peace-loving people. In World War II...
We're also achievement-oriented.
Yes, and we could see in World War II the lines moving forward. There was some notion of when it would come to an end. We never reached a point in Vietnam where we could honestly say to our people, this is going to be over, roughly such and such a
day. But then that means you dishonestly said that to the people.
No, I didn't.
No, you didn't, but the administration did. McNamara was always telling us in Westmoreland and so on.
Oh, well, there was once in 1964 when, or 63 as a matter of fact, when we got relatively optimistic about the situation out there, based upon false information, by the way, from the South Vietnamese. And Secretary McNamara made a remark that he later very much regretted about.
Home for Christmas.
Home concept. For Christmas, and maybe in 65, that kind of thing. No, I can understand this element of impatience. These two things combined had a lot to do with how things really worked out in Vietnam.
Well, does this suggest that if you had to do it again, and you were faced with the following alternatives, i.e. simply pulling out of SATO or just making excuses, or fighting the war conclusively, have you asked yourself the question which of those two you would do?
I haven't revisited that question because anything that I feel now could not possibly affect what happened.
No, but it could instruct future administrations, can't it?
I must say that that I'm very much concerned about the possibility of miscalculation in the capitals of major countries in the event of in a nuclear world. And at least at this point, quite apart from what might happen later now in Southeast Asia, other capitals know that the United States invested more than $100 billion in 50,000 lives in trying to make good on its treaty commitment. Now, that may cause other capitals to pause before they assume that we will do nothing in other situations.
On the other hand, aren't they primarily struck by the improbability that America would make a similar gesture? You just finished saying if the American people feel they're going to have to lose 50,000 people, $100 billion every decade for this, they're going to retreat from these commitments. So mightn't a critic of yours say precisely what you ended up proving by the Vietnam venture was that foreign capitals could afford to take risks?
Well, that was the general view at the end of the Korean War, that this kind of thing could never happen again. But I remind you that as late as last October, when apparently, and I have no inside information on this, the administration believed that there was an alert of Soviet forces with regard to the Middle East. When the president moved our own forces to a minor step up in the alert stages, there was pretty strong bipartisan support for the action that he took.
May I interrupt you to say that Mr. Kissinger told me that it was a lucky damn thing it was Israel involved, because he doubted that there would have been bipartisan support at any other front. That it is the peculiar, passionate, sentimental, if you like, strategic commitment to Israel that that caused politically to survive that reaction of Richard Nixon. That the whole Vietnamese experience would have made it impossible to summon bipartisan support in behalf of Berlin or any place else. You agree?
Well, no, I don't agree on that. In the first place, I think the intensity of that reaction that you spoke of is felt most in Washington and New York, but is not felt out in other parts of the country nearly to the same extent. I think that people generally realize that the Middle East is an extremely important place, there are major stakes there, and if we...
No, I'm agreeing with you, but I'm saying that the confidence you seem to put in the American in the American public's backing of a stern White House reply to the Soviet Union, if it comes through with a salient here or there, is not shared by the incumbent Secretary of State. He felt that it was the presence of Israel as the intended victim that midwife this support.
Well, I would think that if Berlin were involved, or NATO were involved, or Japan were involved, that there'd be plenty of support. I have great confidence in the common sense of the American people at the end of the day on things like that.
We're all dead.
Even though yes, this is pretty risky business.
But you said that you underestimated, or rather overestimated, the patience of the Americans.
I overestimated their patience, yes.
So therefore, our victory should be quicker than the one you
saw. Yes, and this creates a problem, because does our experience in Vietnam mean that...
No graduated response.
That we have lowered the threshold of possible nuclear war. In other words, that we may have to consider, if we go into anything of this sort again, God forbid, that we have to go all out, bang, 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 and take the consequences up or down.
What do you conclude?
I must say I'm a little worried about that, because whether we're talking about the guerrilla operations in Greece in the 1948 period, or the Berlin blockade, or the Korean War, or the Southeast Asian War, we or the West have tried to use the amount of force that is required to achieve the essential objectives without letting it escalate into general war.
But you used less force than was required this last time around, didn't you?
Well, I think the end of the story has not yet been fully told. I think in general, I would think perhaps we did, yes. Required, in one sense, Mr. Buckley, but where was the threshold of direct military involvement with the People's Republic of China or with the Soviet Union? I could have advised the president that he could destroy North Vietnam by heavy bombing, move ground forces up there, and that the Chinese would not do anything about it. Had he taken that advice and the Chinese had moved in, I could have picked up the phone and called and said, "Sorry, Mr. President, I was wrong." To whom does he telephone? Mm-hmm. You see, the president has to live, and the nation, have to live with the consequences, whatever they are, when decisions of that sort are taken. And it's an incredibly lonesome and heavy responsibility.
Did you ever come close to making such a recommendation?
No.
Mr. Rick Allen is with the Atlantic Constitution. Mr. Allen.
Mr. Rusk, I'd like to ask you this. Leaving aside the possibilities of revisionism for the moment, it appears that you may be remembered as the architect of the most unpopular war in our country's history, while Henry Kissinger may be remembered as the architect of peace. Does this concern you? Do you feel like a victim of history?
Well, history will only be fragmentary at best. 2,100,000 cables went out of the Department of State with my name signed to them in a period of 8 years. And so alongside of the Vietnam War were things like the Nuclear Test Ban Treaty, the Non-Proliferation Treaty on Nuclear Weapons, the Civil Air Agreement of the Soviet Union, the Consular Agreement of the Soviet Union, the Peace Corps, the Alliance for Progress, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Now, my guess is that not all of those things will be put into a single volume because, in the first place, they could not be crammed into a single volume, and if they were put into several volumes, no one would read them. So I think it's probable that Vietnam will be a rather central subject of any writing about my tour as Secretary of State. I regret that, but it's inevitable, and I have to take the responsibility for it.
Let me ask you a further question. Were the government in Saigon to fall to the North Vietnamese anytime in the near future, how do you think this would affect the view in the future of what the war in Vietnam meant in the period before now?
Well, I think it was necessary for President Nixon or any president to move to withdraw our forces from Southeast Asia, because no president can sustain forces in combat for any significant period of time without the understanding and support of the American people and the American Congress. I thoroughly understood his desire to leave behind something that made sense. Now, there was a good many people who thought that he moved too slowly to get our troops out of there. I think the paper agreements that were reached were not bad. But whether there will be performance on those paper agreements is a wholly different question. I understand the Ho Chi Minh Trail is paved. I understand that...
You had some nice paper agreements involving Laos in 1962.
Yes, and we got no performance on them whatever. I think it's a little speculative still. We don't know how this story is going to come out.
Yeah, but he's not predicting how. He's asking what would happen if it comes out tails.
I think there will be a further erosion in the first instance in Southeast Asia itself. I don't believe in the domino theory, but it's just in the nature of a successful effort of any group committed to something that they call their world revolution to want to move on to the next target. And I would be concerned about Thailand, Burma, and then later on some of the other countries of Southeast Asia.
What I was getting at was this: if the Saigon government were to fall, do you think that those who were proponents of the war in Vietnam would tend to have a more favorable place in history?
I don't know. I'm in a rather curious position on this because I hope that the that the events of the next two or three decades will be so constructive in the direction of a more stable peace in the world that the future historian will be tempted to say, well, President Kennedy, President Johnson, and those fellows, Rusk and McNamara, tried too hard. What they did in Southeast Asia was not necessary. What I don't want is the kind of justification that would come from a few miserable survivors in a salt mine in New Mexico looking at each other and saying, gee, those fellows were right after all. I mean, nobody could possibly want the kind of justification that would come from a deterioration of the situation into general violence in the world.
Miss Sally Lofton is with the Southeastern newspapers. Miss Lofton?
I think what you were just saying was, I was going to ask whether you thought if in the future, say within the next 50 years, historians, when they were looking back on the Vietnam War, they would look at it, if they would view it as the big mistake as it's seen now.
I think it's too early to tell. In the first place, the story has not ended in Southeast Asia, nor do we know what else is going to happen during that period, which might be related to judgments in people's minds, which they might draw from the experience in Southeast Asia.
I'd like to ask one more question, if it's okay. You mentioned that there was a reaction against revision historians. Was this reaction from the public? And what do you think generated it?
Well, I get some feeling of this from some of the articles in some of the historical journals and from some of the discussions at historical meetings and from my own colleagues and as I visit different campuses. I don't believe that the revisionist historians are going to dominate the writing of history of the period from 1945, say, to 1970. I think there'll be a much greater diversity of view, and that as the evidence now becomes available, there will be more hard material injected into historical writing than has been possible up to this point.
Do you think that, the tide, for instance, quotes in favor, unquotes, of Hitler, ever reached as high level in the academies, say, in England as here, A.J.P. Taylor and all those people? The notion that it was primarily the Western powers who were responsible for the Second World War?
Well, you know, responsibility involves two sides of a coin. I don't believe that the British, the French, the Belgians attacked Germany. But on the other hand, all of us during that period may have tempted thieves. I mentioned the overnight massive demobilization of the United States after World War II.
Which is provocative.
Which was provocative. It exposed Stalin to intolerable temptations. Now, the democracies in Western Europe, and we helped, caused Hitler to believe, for example, that Britain would not fight. Mm-hmm. I was in the Oxford Union on the night they passed that resolution that this House will not fight for king and country. Mm-hmm. And he believed that under no circumstances would the United States ever get into a war of that sort, you see. So we allowed miscalculations and misjudgments to occur, which cost 50 million dead. Now, this is the thing that bothers me. It's not counting missiles. It's the perceptions in people's minds that make the difference, because human beings, identifiable specific human beings, make these decisions which lead to utter catastrophe.
Mr. John Hamm is with the Columbus Ledger. Mr. Hamm.
Mr. Russ, you pointed out that President Kennedy was the first president ever to be born in this century, and that he wanted to take a fresh look at foreign policy, and that he, in fact, didn't ask for Berlin, the Cuban Missile Crisis, or Vietnam. And the revisionists make a strong case, I think, that possibly he did ask for these things. One being, the first thing he did was ask for a $3 billion increase in the defense budget. He sent made his famous bomb shelter speech, and he also asked for a tripling of the draft. All of these actions, which Khrushchev thought were provocative, how do you feel about that? And also the Bay of Pigs, which led to missiles even being brought to Cuba in the first place.
Well, what the connection was between the great failure and mistake of the Bay of Pigs and the introduction of missiles in Cuba, I'm not sure. My own guess is that the decision to try to put missiles in Cuba was taken considerably before the Bay of Pigs business, because everything came in there prefabricated. And it was a tremendous technical achievement to convert an empty cow pasture into a missile site within a week or 10 days. But I don't know that.
But it was 18 months, wasn't it?
About 18 months, yes. But I think that decision was made long before the missiles came into Cuba. Well, I think President Kennedy believed that our national defenses needed strengthening. He had, after all, campaigned on a missile gap, which perhaps wasn't as much of a gap as he thought it was when he was campaigning. You know, we've tried for years to get the Soviet Union to sit down with us and talk to us about the components in each other's military budget. See, today about 60% of our military budget is in fact a social cost. That is, it's pay rather than military muscle. Whereas the Soviet Union does not pay its private soldiers $300 a month plus clothing, plus food, plus housing, and so forth. We want to get these budgets on a comparable basis, but the Soviet Union has never been willing to discuss that. So it's a little hard sometimes to know exactly where comparability lies and how much one ought to do. But I thought that the principal increase in President Kennedy's proposals for the defense budget came after President Khrushchev had hit him with this ultimatum on Berlin and in Vienna in June 61.
Well, the
in any case, it was a reiteration of a previous ultimatum,
right,
given under Eisenhower.
That's right.
Well, there wasn't. Didn't President Kennedy indicate a disinclination to negotiate at all on Berlin, and that that
I hope so.
That was why the wall was put up in the first place. I mean, I believe from what I've read that Mr. Khrushchev, all he wanted was to have the United States sit down and talk about it.
Oh, no. Mr. Khrushchev wanted Western troops out of Berlin, possibly a corporal's guard as a sort of a token. He wanted to turn access to Berlin over to the East Germans. And in Vienna in June 61, he said in the most brutal terms, and if the Western powers interfere with the control of this access by the East Germans, there will be war. And the last words that President Kennedy said to Chairman Khrushchev at that meeting were, well then, Mr. President, there will be war. It's going to be a very cold winter. Now, when you say negotiate, we talked and talked and talked and talked about Berlin following that June 1961 meeting. Either at the top or in my own relations with Mr. Gromyko or through our ambassadors. Now, if you mean by negotiation, give them three-fourths of what they want, well, where does that lead us? If they take the general view, and this is a pretty trite saying, that what is mine and what is yours has to be divided, they'll nibble you to death. So, yes, we were prepared to talk, and we did talk. But we weren't prepared to give up Berlin.
So you don't think that Khrushchev interpreted this as in any way provocative? It was simply a continuation of the Eisenhower policy. That the freedom of Berlin was not negotiable.
That's right. After all, we were in Berlin on the same basis on which the Soviet Union was in Berlin. Mm-hmm. Namely, as victorious powers in World War II. And our view was that the Soviet Union could not give to the East Germans what the Soviet Union themselves did not have, namely Allied rights in West Berlin. And so we had quite a tussle over that, but finally succeeded in talking the fever out of the situation, and finally it just petered out. Into a wall which was put in there to stop the hemorrhage of people out of East Germany.
Stalin.
Yeah, I have one more thing that concerns me a little bit, and I just want to make a point, if perhaps you'd respond to it.
By all means.
It seemed to me that you were saying that in underestimating the patience of the American people...
Overestimating, right.
That you were implying somehow that the only thing that Americans found wrong with the war in Vietnam was that it went on too long, rather than some of us felt that it was positively wrong and worked positively to bring it to an end.
About 5% in 1965.
Well, see, I think yours
related to your question,
there are only two people on the Gulf of Tonkin, right, who voted against it.
I'm not sure that you can equate a vote in the Gulf of Tonkin with feelings.
Well, it was a vote authorizing any kind of action. There was no protest when he in fact took action to speak of. I mean, you and Dwight MacDonald are the only two people I can think of.
You see, I came down here as late as 1966 to a rally in the Atlanta Stadium called Affirmation Vietnam, organized by the students of the colleges and universities of this region. That could not have happened in 67 or 68. But on your particular point, I think there's another mistake we probably made, and that is not to press the Congress for a vote on Vietnam, up or down, at least each year. But when we raised that with some of the leaders there, they said, look, the same resolution will pass, but it will pass by a reduced majority. Therefore, why don't you live with the Gulf of Tonkin resolution?
Because otherwise the enemy would project that.
That's
so
right.
All we have to do is hang
That's
on
right.
the next couple of years.
But in retrospect, I think the Congress ought to have had their feet held to the fire each year with a vote.
May I ask you a question, Mr. Rusk? On the bombing of Cambodia, as authorized by Richard Nixon, do you as a lawyer and as a former Secretary of State believe that he acted unconstitutionally?
No, I don't think so. I would have to look to see what the
Constitution says.
What resolutions? I sort of forget which resolutions might have been passed by that time. But I think the President, as Commander in Chief, has very wide latitude in terms of the strategy of a war in which the Congress has participated. For example, I don't believe President Roosevelt had to go to Congress on the question of whether we went into Europe through Normandy or through the salt on the belly.
There was declaration of war there.
Oh, yes, but since declarations of war have gone out of style now internationally, I don't know of one since 1945. Maybe there have been one or two in part of Arab countries in the June 67 fracas in the Middle East, but declarations of war are rapidly disappearing. That doesn't mean that the war powers of Congress have disappeared, but they can exercise those war powers by resolutions which stop short of bringing into being the legal state of war. So I wouldn't draw as much distinction as your question suggested between a formal declaration of war and something less than a declaration of war. The North Vietnamese were strongly present in Cambodia. And as early as my time there, there were some understandings with Prince Sihanouk, which I undoubtedly would now deny, that under certain circumstances and in certain areas, if we felt it necessary to do something to the North Vietnamese that were over the border in his country, and if we didn't tag him with the responsibility, that we'd go ahead and do it. So I wasn't, frankly, as much concerned about that strike against the so-called sanctuaries in Cambodia as some other people were.
Yet, but as I understand it, the constitutional issue is not, is a bombing that we conduct satisfactory to a foreign prince, but to the local Congress?
Well, I suspect that's a political question rather than a constitutional question.
So you don't predict that they're going to take this one too far in the impeachment or discussions against
the president? I would be surprised. I would think that would be a rather poor ground.
And it would be a poor ground because you think that the manifest logic of what Nixon did would ultimately overwhelm the people, or because you think there is a scholarship to vindicate him?
I think there are a lot of precedents. And I think when one thinks about the possible requirements of the future, we better be just a little careful about restricting the freedom of action of the Commander-in-Chief with regard to strategic decisions, although, in my judgment, the Congress and the President should join in the preceding policy decision as to the commitment of American forces.
Thank you very much, Mr. Rusk. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen of the panel. Thank you, students of Emory and Georgia U.
Next week, former Jesuit and author Malachi Martin joins Mr. Buckley for a repeat of the Jesus Movement.
For a printed bound copy of this program, send 25 cents in coin to Firing Line, Post Office Box 5966, Columbia, South Carolina 29250. That's 25 cents to Firing Line, Post Office Box 5966, Columbia, South Carolina 29250. This program was made possible by a grant from the Corporation for Public Broadcasting.